Good afternoon, everybody. That might have been too much if I was still at the mic. So, I don't know about you all, but I've been waiting for today. I have been waiting for this afternoon. I think I can speak for the co-planners when we say we are so glad that we are going to be rounding out the third day of this first conference focusing on Black girls, with Black girls talking to us and telling us about their experience. So make sure that you are listening, that you are tweeting what they say accurately, and that you are really taking in the charges that they are giving us this afternoon. So again, thank you for being here. I wanna give some love again to all the folks who have helped us be here. A super shout out to the volunteers from the Institute of Research in African American Studies. They've been phenomenal. Thank you so much, IRAS, for being the space that hosts us here at Columbia University. We appreciate it. To Farah, Joanne, Carla, Camille, Amy, Kira, Cher, Salamisha, love you so much and look forward to what we do moving forward from the conference. So a whole lot of love for Black girls has been expressed in this space over the last 2.5 days, and it's so important to us that we end letting you hear from these girls. So I'm gonna make it as easy as possible for you to hear from them by moving them right onto the stage right now. So first up, we have Olivia Allen representing the I Can Be Girls Conference all the way from Louisville, Kentucky. Next up, we have MyAsia Clark all the way from Brooklyn, New York. MyAsia is representing Girls from Girls for Gender Equity. You. Next, we have Marley Diaz of 1,000 Black Girls Books from West Orange, New Jersey. It's like I'm calling up the dream team. Y'all feeling me? Next up, we have Danielle Gary, representing Girls Educational and Mentoring Services, also known as GEMS. Yeah. We have more space for fabulousness because we're calling up next Asia Willis from A Long Walk Home, representing Chicago. Okay. I see you. And last, but definitely not least, from my heart, representing the Brotherhood Sister Soul, Ajara Stewart. Yes. Can we give it up one more time for them? So I know folks have been excited these last couple of days of people who are scholars and researchers and running nonprofits and taking care of Black girls, and you've been quoting them, and you probably have some of their quotes in your pocket or on your t-shirt right now. These are the next ones that you want to be quoting, okay? These are our next professors and scholars and just healers of the world, and let you know what needs to happen and what needs to be done. So again, focus up and listen up. Let's give them another round of applause. So to start us off and to give them an opportunity to tell you more about who they are and why they're at the table, I want to bring into the space something that was said yesterday, because it speaks directly to why we are having this conference in the first place. And it comes from one of the panelists yesterday who said to us something very profound that made all of us think, wow. She said, everyone has an agenda for what Black girlhood is, but no one really cares about Black girls. And so I want to let you all know that we care about you, we see you, we love you, and we are so glad that you're here to tell us your truth today. So as you go down the line and say a few words about yourself and what brought you to the table, also tell us, what does Black girlhood mean to you? We'll start with Olivia.
Hi, I'm Olivia Allen. I'm 11 years old, and I'm in fifth grade. I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, and I am the founder of the I Can Be Girls Confidence Conference, which is a conference designed to help instill confidence in girls ages 8 to 12. And I really came up with this conference last year when I did a food drive with my friend, and I realized she had a lot of boldness going up to everybody asking them for donations. And when I had to slow her down and tell her, wait, we have to still organize, sort, and box the donations that we already had. And I realized not many girls that I knew had as much confidence as she did. And so I wanted to do something to change that. And so I decided to do a conference. And so I named it the I Can Be a Girls Confidence Conference. And that's why I'm here today. And I think black girlhood, people tell black girls what to do and what they should do. And if they're not a black girl, they don't know how it feels, because black people were treated wrong and with disrespect, and women were treated wrong with disrespect. So to have those two in the same character, it makes it that much more difficult. And so if you're not a black girl and someone's telling you what to do, and they're not, well, if you're a black girl and someone's telling you what to do and they're not a black girl, they don't know how it feels. And I just think that people say, what are you gonna do as a black girl? Well, I am, and people think there's a difference between black girls and girls. Well, I'm still a girl. I am a girl, a regular girl, just with a different skin tone. And so I just think black girlhood means being yourself and being confident in who you are, not letting anyone else tell you who you are and what you should do if they're not you. So.
Hi, my name is Maisha Clark. I'm 17 years old. I am a part of Sisters in Strength, which is a branch of Girls for Gender Equity. I'm here today because starting last year, in my junior year of high school, I experienced school pushout, and that was around the time that I joined Girls for Gender Equity, and I didn't know what school pushout was. I didn't know what I was experiencing, and I didn't have a voice in my school. So now, to fast forward to where I am now, I know what school pushout is. I know how to stand up against it. I know what it means to be a black girl. Yeah, that's why I'm here. I'm also here to share my story, and hopefully it inspires other people to leave today, and like just reach out to other black girls and like let them know that you care for them and that you're here for them. To me, black girlhood is, I feel like it's everything that I've learned at Girls for Gender Equity, which is to be strong, to have a voice, to speak up for myself, to be who I am unapologetically. And when I say unapologetically, like, I am not sorry for anything that I do. I do everything head first. I think about it, and I know who I am and who I want to be.
Hello, my name is Marley Dias. I'm 11 years old, and I'm the creator of the 1,000 Black Girl Books campaign. So, thank you. So, in this campaign, I was seeing in my fifth grade class that there wasn't any books where black girls were the main characters being featured as something that we were supposed to be reading in class. So I told my mom, and she said, well, what are you gonna do about it? So I decided to start a campaign in which I was gonna collect 1,000 books where black girls are the main character and then give them to a school in Jamaica. And after that, we succeeded with that project and that part of the project. And now, because we've had so many donations from people from social media and publishing companies, we've been able to give to schools in West Orange, New Jersey, Newark, and hopefully Connecticut soon on April 29th. And thank you. And black girlhood to me is kind of two different things, in the sense that for me, I've always been surrounded by strong black women who love themselves and know what they want. So for me, it's just kind of like breathing. It doesn't feel anything different from what I see everywhere else. But for the girls that I've met when I'm doing this project, sometimes it's hard because I have two things against them, the race, that they're black, and that they're seeing all these black men and black women being killed by the police, and all these dangerous things against us, and that they're women. So they have these things that boys and men say they can't do, but they should be. So I'm here today to share my story and to show people how they can help to create literacy in communities where black girls live.
My name is Danielle Gary, and I work at GEMS, Girls Educational Mentoring Services. We work with girls 12 to 24 who have experienced commercial sexual exploitation and domestic trafficking, and that's something that doesn't get spoken about a lot, particularly in the black community. So I am here as a survivor of CSEC and as an advocate for black girls. And to me, black girlhood is identifying things that are wrong, doing my best to change them, and making the world a better place than how I found it.
Hey. I'm sorry, I'm nervous. I'm kind of nervous. My name is Asia Willis. I'm 16 years old. I'm from Chicago, Illinois. I'm here with a Long Walk Home Girlfriends program, and that's a nonprofit organization that uses arts to end gender-based violence against girls and women with high school students. I'm here because, like, I love being a black girl, and I just love black girls. Like, I feel like this conference shines so much positivity on being a black girl, and it's like the essence of what being a black girl is. So, and what comes to mind when I think of black girlhood is being special. I feel like black girls, we go through so much, like, in our lifetime, and the way we cope and the way we get through it, like, so gracefully, that just makes us sparkle even more so.
Hi, my name is Ajara Stewart. I'm a member of Brotherhood Sister Soul, an active member. And what being a black girl means to me, I'm very eccentric, so I guess that's one. And just allowing yourself to be yourself and not conform. Also allowing people or black girls who aren't like you to be themselves without putting them into a box. So I guess being a black girl is allowing other black girls to be who they are in their own right, and you being who you are, and accepting one another regardless.
Right? It is amazing. And so just to recap, we have allowing black girls to be exactly who they are. That black girlhood means we sparkle, we're special, the love of being a black girl. That black girlhood means doing our best to change the world, that it's about literacy that centers black girls and their experiences, that black girlhood is about being strong, having voice, being unapologetically a black girl, and also that we just need to stop telling black girls what to do and how to be, right? So just take those gems for right now as well. I want to bring into the space something that Danielle shared, that there's so many things that we don't often talk about. And so wanting to bring up another space in which we don't always talk about when we think about black girls, which is around our physical abilities, right? And so I want to give a shout out to a group that came out to this conference. It's Access Living Empowered Fifis. They facilitated an amazing workshop to talk about black girls and girls of color experiences of varying abilities. So I don't know where y'all are at right now, but what's up? And just some information so people know, right? We have to do better by our girls with disabilities. According to the Department of Education Civil Rights data from 2014, restraint and seclusion by disability status and race, students with disabilities represent 12% of the student population, but 58% of those placed in seclusion or involuntary confinement, and 75% of those physically restrained at school to immobilize them or reduce their ability to move freely. Black students represent 19% of students with disabilities, but 36% of these students who are restrained at school through the use of mechanical devices or equipment designed to restrict their freedom of movement. All right, so we want to make sure that we're lifting up that space, that we're paying attention to our girls of color with different abilities, and that we're creating a space in which they can move freely and express themselves freely, and again, be unapologetically a black girl. So one more shout out for Access Living Empowered Fifi. So I also want to pick up from where my Asia left us, right? Can you tell us a little bit more about the work that is happening at Girls for Gender Equity and what you're up to with Sisters in Strength?
So Sisters in Strength has been working on a project called The School That Our Girls Deserve, because a lot of SIS members have experienced school pushout, or they know someone that experienced school pushout. So we're working on a project in which we're identifying, like, what key things do we need in a school for our black girls to feel comfortable, for us to be educated, and for us not to be pushed into the criminal justice system. We're also working on solutions to school pushout. So we're reading articles, we're telling our own stories and our experiences to, like, open up and gain more knowledge, because we read articles, and I mean, we get facts, but who can tell our story better than us?
Okay. That's it. Thank you. And keeping on this trend of talking about education in our minds, I want to pass it on to Marley to talk more about literacy and why that was a space that you wanted to center and help uplift black girls and girls of color.
So literacy is something that has been pushed in my community and in a lot of others. So it's like a thing that reading is very important, and it teaches kids how to express themselves. And it's especially important when you have something that you can automatically connect with. Because when you see anything, there's always something in your mind that's triggering it back to your experiences. And when I and the black girls in my classroom weren't seeing any black girls, we weren't getting all these messages in our head, because there was nothing for us to just center that around. So that's definitely something, literacy, that's always getting pushed, but at the same time, we're not having it for everyone. It's like, America's a diverse place, but why is literature not diverse? So it's always been something that's been on my mind, and that's how I started the project.
Thank you. Right. And so that's an amazing question. And so for all the black girls and girl of color writers in here, write, publish. For those publishers in the house, those adults who have books that are published, talk to a black girl, talk to a girl of color, tell her what you did to get published, so we have more girls that are centering our experiences, and more of those books are coming from the girls themselves. So this is a space for us to connect, right? I want to move on to Danielle. If you can tell us some of the work that you're doing at GEMS and how that speaks to our bodies as black girls and girls of color.
I'm the training and technical assistance coordinator at GEMS, so my role there involves going out to different organizations, i.e. child welfare, sometimes police forces, other agencies that work with youth of color who are of low socioeconomic status, and training them about CSEC. What are the risk factors for CSEC? How does it happen? Why does it happen? And what can we do to stop it? And although when I do train, I don't identify as a survivor, I am. And that enforces the way that I present this matter. So, right, being able to identify as a survivor, but not have that be the sole, you know, not have that be the center of what it is that I do is very empowering for me. So most of my work at GEMS, all of my work at GEMS is focused around empowering girls who have been trafficked and letting them know that they are more than a survivor, and then helping them access the things that they need to be able to sustain healthy survivorship, and teaching them, showing them, being a role model for what that looks like.
Thank you.
And so Asia at A Long Walk Home also does work around gender-based violence. Can you tell us some of what you are doing with your activism with the Girlfriends Project?
What we're doing at Girlfriends, what we're doing at Girlfriends, like around gender-based violence and things like that, I don't know if you all were like, not all of y'all was in our workshop, there's not enough people, but if anyone has ever heard of Rakia Boyd, and to advocate her story, Rakia Boyd, she's from Chicago, Illinois, where I'm from, and she was gunned down by a off-duty white policeman, and it was just recently the 4-year anniversary of her death, so I had went around to my classes and I advocated for her. We made buttons for her. We've just been getting the word out about her. And Girlfriends, we're going to try to make a permanent memorial in Douglas Park, which is where she was killed, to honor her legacy.
Thank you. And thank you so much for lifting Rakia Boyd's name. Oftentimes in the climate that we are, we so readily hear about black men and boys who are in harm's way as it has to do with state violence, and we don't often hear about what happens to our girls, right? We forget about their names, or we don't show up in mass to support them. And so thank you so much for lifting Rakia Boyd. Thank you for that. I want to talk about spirit now. And so a lot of Ajara's experience at the Brotherhood Sister Soul is in all girls' spaces. Can you tell us a little bit what it's meant for your spirit to be, to have that all girls' space, Ajara?
Being in an all girls' space allows me to grow. And I believe that allows me to grow much faster than someone who isn't in an all-girls space, because I have so many different personalities and we're all growing and learning from each other and hearing each other's story. And for me, my all-girls space is predominantly Latin and African American. So we are sharing stories, relating to one another, and growing from our experiences. So it means a lot that I have that space. I think that a lot of the times we say that I'm growing every day, I'm changing every day, but I am literally changing every Monday. they are a lot. So it is a lot to learn from. Can't explain it. It's just so much. Every Monday I go in and there's something new, and my perception or my beliefs around that something is always changing because I'm relating to my sister and her story. And it's not just so cut and dry. It's not so black and white. Now it's being related to someone who I know and whom I love, and my story or my perception is changing every day. I'm becoming more human and I'm relating. And I think that that is one of the biggest benefits of being in an all-girl space.
Thank you, Jar. And so, Olivia, confidence. Tell us more about how that feeds the spirit of black girls, or how that's fed your spirit, being able to host this conference in your hometown, talking about girls building their self-esteem and exuding confidence.
Confidence has really helped me, because confidence is a thing that really everyone needs, especially girls and black girls, because black girls are treated unfairly. Like I said earlier, black people are treated unfairly and women were treated unfairly. So to have those two things in the same kind of character makes it really difficult to be treated fairly within that. And to have confidence in yourself, like in my workshop, we talked about different things that try to steal your confidence, like the like a girl phrase and social media and popularity. And just black girls having confidence is really something, the key to being yourself. And so to confidence feeds into your character by you having confidence in your who you are and who you want to be and who you can be. And so confidence has really helped me over the years because you can do whatever you need to be confident in yourself, like music and dancing and acting has helped me. And sometimes talking to my friends about it, talking to my mom about it, problems that I have, having lack of confidence. And so confidence has helped me over the years grow and become better because in like first or second grade, I didn't really know what to do because there were a lot of white girls that I had. Like I have a bunch of friends that are white and it's no problem. They don't have a problem with me. We get along fine. And I used to be self-conscious about if I should have friends like that, but they were perfect to me and I grew more confidence through that. And so I think confidence really helps black girls when they don't have other people around them that are the same race or gender as them. And just confidence in being their selves, just to be a black girl, being proud of being black, it's really how it is.
Thank you. Thank you, Olivia. And so just wanting to go back to the workshops for a second. So how many people in the room enjoyed the workshops that they participated in? Yes. Just really quickly from the audience, just popcorn style, what were some of the things that you did in your workshop activities? Some people danced. Some people made unicorns. Vision boards. vision boards. Anybody else? Some people made buttons. Right? And so for the crew that was in the workshop that did vision boards, you were having a conversation with Ajara about power. Ajara, why did you want to do a workshop about power? You could have done it about anything. Why was it so important for you to focus on power at this conference about black girls?
A few days ago, I was actually prepping for this workshop, and I wasn't so sure what I wanted the theme to be, but I was having a conversation with a few alumni who was helping me prep, and the word power came up. And it was a complicated word because no one wants to feel like someone has more power than them. And some people aren't able to identify their own powers without comparing it to someone else's. So I thought that it was interesting that it was hard for them to accept the word, let alone me use the word, because I didn't want to offend anyone. So when I decided to do this workshop, I said, I'm going to allow the girls to identify what power is to them and what makes them powerful, versus me asking them what a powerful woman is, what makes a woman powerful. Because worded differently, it is so much different. And I don't think we realize that. Our words mean a lot, and what we say means a lot, and it affects the way that people perceive things. So this workshop meant a lot to me, and it definitely gave me some insight on how people perceive things and what to say and what not to say.
So Danielle, you and I were talking weeks ago, getting prepped for this. And in our conversation, we talked about misconceptions about black girls. And you said something I had to write down because I did not want to forget it. You said what black girls need, people are misconstrued about what black girls need because people do not ask black girls themselves, right? So we don't know what you all need because we don't ask you. If you can speak a little bit more about that and other misconceptions you think folks have about black girls, specifically black girls that you see and work with at gyms.
Mm-hmm.
Well, specifically, like kind of ping-ponging off that idea about power, a big misconception is that black girls and black women don't have any power. The real issue is that the power that we have is not the type of power that is politically correct and acceptable. So when I come to you with the real Holyfield in my power and in my black girlness,
okay.
If it's not perceived well, then I am perceived as being powerless. Not so. And I think that I really was politicized when I started saying things that weren't right, things that people wanted to talk about. Because the fact of the matter is if we're gonna talk about the state of black girls and we're both comfortable, then we're not having the right conversation.
Mm.
So being comfortable with saying those things, because right, what you say does matter, but also what you don't say matters, right? If after I tell you, then you know, and you can no longer say that you didn't. So I think that that is where I have found my power, and that is the type of power that I try to instill in every girl that I touch, regardless of whether they're at Gems, in a bodega, on the A-train, right? That is something that I try to give, that power. There is power in words. Your voice is your power, and you have to let people know that you have it.
So one of the things that you talked about just now, Danielle, you talked about being politicized, right? And so many of the young people at the table would identify as being activists in some respect. And so I want to give some space for you, my Asia, to tell your story and how you became an activist. What happened?
In my 11th grade year, my aunt passed away from lung cancer. And my father is in the criminal justice system. My father's been in the criminal justice system since before I was born. So specifically in 11th grade, he went to the parole board and he got sentenced to 2 more years. I was in school and it was like a really difficult time for me because both things happened back to back. So it was a situation in which I had no support in school. So like when teachers would say something to me, if it was on a wrong day and I just woke up not feeling it, my response was either kiss my behind or did somebody piss in your coffee this morning? Like, because I had no support, like I didn't know who to turn to, like who can I give this anger and like this stressful situation to? So I decided to open up at GGE and like let my Sisters and Strength members know and let Joanne know and other members at GGE, like what was going on with me. And there they supported me and let me know that like being suspended for a teacher disrespecting me and telling me I can't just simply like call my mother to have like a conversation with her for her to give me like a pep talk just to bring me back down. Or a teacher disrespecting me and telling me I'm loud, I'm rude, I'm aggressive, I'm the typical angry black woman, and me getting suspended because I'm telling her her comments is wrong and I feel disrespected. It was things like that that caused me to wake up and realize like I am being pushed out of school, because for my whole 11th grade year, I was only in school for maybe 100 days. The other days I was suspended. So when I finished off my 11th grade year, I was told that I wasn't going to be a senior. So I was like, why would I not be a senior when I'm getting suspended for the things that you guys did to me? So I like stood up and there was like a whole big conversation between me and my principal when I told him I don't feel like it's right because I got suspended for your rules. I didn't get suspended on my own behalf. So now I'm a senior and
you're right.
Thank you. Now I'm a senior, and there's still like some ignorance and negative feedback and comments that I received like in school for like past actions, and there's still teachers that say disrespectful things to me, but I know how to go about it now.
Thank you, Alicia.
Yeah. So I think your story so much speaks to voice and power and standing up for yourself, and in that way being able to stand up for other girls who are being pushed out. So folks got to hear from and Monique Morris in these earlier days, her book and work around school push out and how that impacts Black girls specifically. And so, you know, this is a real story here about what that experience is and has been. And so congratulations on your pending graduation from high school.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. And a shout out to everybody who's a part of the class of 2016. We got a lot of seniors here. And on to amazing things after you graduate from high school. So we are going to be tying things together in a few moments. And so want to give space for folks on the panel to talk about what's new, what's next, what's coming up for you. And so we have people who are active on social media. Please tell people how they can stay connected with you. Folks who have other conferences that are coming up, people who might need some of you to mobilize for action, especially those of you who are in New York, and ways in which people can just stay connected. And so I want to give the floor to Olivia to tell us what's coming up next for you. So you're at this conference, but you have another conference coming up. Tell us about that.
Yes, my second girls' conference will be on Saturday, August 27, 2016. It's in Louisville, Kentucky at Simmons College of Kentucky, and the registrations start in June at the website www.icanbeconference.com. And you could also sign up for the newsletters at www.oliviacallen.weebly.com. And I also am working on a service project right now, trying to contact Waterstep for a shoe drive. So, yeah.
All right, big thing. Hey now, it took a committee of nine. Committee of one is holding down that conference. Good job. Marley, tell us what's coming up next and new for you.
So there's one thing that I didn't really think through when I started the project that now we're going to continue over the summer. So when you read a book, you're going to finish it. And I didn't really think that part through for the people that had finished my books by the time since I went in Jamaica to February. So now I've decided to start a Black Girl Book Club in which I would pick a book, a Black Girl book, and anyone who wanted to read it would be able to read it. And then we'd have a discussion over Skype and in person with the author in six different places over the summer. And I am not the only girl in my community of Black girls who's doing social action. Now my project is still continuing going, but I work with a foundation for women and girls called the Grassroots Community Foundation, in which they teach you about all the aspects of health, the economics of health, physical health, mental health, and sexual health. So each girl who's in the middle school age and who goes to this camp that I go to called Super Camp, they have to use their gifts and talents to create a project. And I was the first one and mine was a success, but many of my other friends are going to be working on projects. So I would really appreciate it if you were to go to @grassrootsfround and on Instagram and look at what those girls are doing too.
Yes. And thank you for shouting out other girls who are doing amazing work. One of the things that we keep saying is that there could be so many other people who were at the panel. You are the ones who are here and you represent so many other amazing Black girls doing amazing things, not only in your hometowns, but across the country. So thank you so much for that. Asia, what's new for girlfriends? What are you doing in Chi-Town that we need to pay attention to?
Like I said earlier, we're gonna start working on a permanent memorial for Rakia Boy in the summer, and we want to have that ready by next year, October. And also we are thinking about, well not thinking about, we're gonna expand our curriculum, which is Girl Me, Girl Culture, and Girl Power, and get that into different schools for different girls. And if you wanna help out with that or be a part of Rakia's memorial, you can like us on Facebook @A Long Walk Home.
Thank you. Danielle, so much of your work at GEMS is about creating a space for girls and young women to heal and to be restored, right? And you talk so much about the importance of survivors being a part of that recovery in a very active way, and that the best strategies come from survivor leadership. Can you talk more about that?
As far as my healing goes, I've found that therapy, like mental health therapy, is one of the things that really grounds me. And I know that in my community of Black people, therapy is really like, oh, why are you going to therapy? You crazy? But, right, we need to, right, be more open to the fact that, one, being a Black girl in itself is a source of trauma. And then all of the things that you could experience just from being a Black girl are also pretty traumatic. So being able to talk about those things, not only with someone who maybe hasn't experienced that trauma, but also in a room of survivors, right? We've had the same experience. 9 times out of 10, we have the same history. We've had the same things happen to us, and we can process those things together. So I do feel like being able to create solutions and talk about those traumas with other people who have experienced them is one of the biggest steps in order to making things better for us, in order to decrease the number of survivors there will be in the future.
Thank you. Ajara, class of 2016. Tell us what you see for yourself in your future journey.
In the near future, I see sleep. But in the future, I see definitely going to Cuba.
Yes, ma'am.
Traveling with Bro Sis internationally for a whole month is something I've done before, and I am very excited about doing it again. After that, college. And then, you know, I'm just so excited about going to college. But before I wasn't, because I was like scared that mom and dad were gonna stop giving me money and buying me stuff. And I almost had a little panic. So like, I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna go to BMCC and we're gonna just have to do it that way. But now that I'm going away and I'm experiencing, you know, I'm experiencing a lot, but going away is going to be a different experience for me, and it's going to allow me to find myself in a new way with people that I don't know, and it's going to change a lot for me, but I know that it's all going to be, in the end, it's going to be positive things. So I'm excited about my journey as growing up and being adult, kind of, sort of, and finding myself and figuring out what it is that I want to do, because I'm thinking about double majoring and I don't really want to do that. So I need to have a space where I can find myself and know who I am more than I do today and every day. So I'm excited about that journey.
Maisha, class of 2016. What's up next for you?
Next for me, I am going to South Africa.
Yeah.
I'm going to South Africa for 2 weeks in July, to Cape Town and Johannesburg. You can find my GoFundMe page at GoFundMe.mc to South Africa. after that, it's college. I'm choosing between two colleges right now, Susquehanna University and Goucher College in Baltimore. So when I make that difficult decision, I'll decide which campus I'll be on and which campus I will be turning upside down.
Hey now. Right, so we have Black girls up here who are traveling, who are turning things upside down, who are supporting us in our recovery and lifting up the need for wellness, who are lifting up the need to center ourselves in literacy, who are speaking about our spirit with confidence and power. And I just want to give you all space to give us a final thought. So whether that is your charge to those of us who are here, something that we need to do for you, you might want to repeat again that GoFundMe. Ways in which you want us to do better by you, better by Black girls. So just take a moment to, you know, think about what that final thought is that you want to leave with us in this space. And so the first person I'm going to ask to share that is Ajara.
Okay. I just want everyone to know that I don't exactly know what I'm about to say. But in general, I think that we need to stop separating each other and trying to categorize one another and start embracing one another's differences instead of shoving each other away because we're different or we don't share the same opinion. And just learning to agree to disagree, because not everyone's going to share the same opinion as you, and not everyone's going to agree with what you agree with, but that's not the biggest thing out there. There are so many other things than who looks better or would you vote for this person or that person, because to be honest, Hillary and Bernie aren't really great candidates.
All right.
Okay? They're not the best. We could do better. So it ain't that deep. Okay? All right.
Thank you, Ajara. Retweet that. Asia.
What I would want everyone to leave like with from this conference is that just Black girls, like, you're beautiful. I feel like in today's society, like in TV shows, like reality TV shows and media, like they try to like break us down and they try to tear us down a lot. And like Black girls, like, just you're beautiful, like you slay, so.
I was just about to get information, but I'm gonna keep seated for right now. But yes, we slayed. Next up, Danielle.
I feel like the question I most often get is, what can I do to help victims of trafficking? You can help them before they become victims of trafficking, right? So you can help them to increase their confidence, their self-esteem, their literacy, the support systems they do have. You can become a part of that. Right, you can influence the path that they will take. And then if they do become a victim, you can help them leave the life and help them become better than they were when they were forced to get in to begin with. So be the change before the victimization happens.
Thank you, Danielle. Marley.
Okay, so there's three things that I have that are really important to me that I want to share. So the first is this thing that I was recently asked about at a panel for the UN, and it was about good girl syndrome, which is a thing that you might have heard of. It's not like an official thing, but it's pretty official in my book. So it's basically when your parents or the people in your community are already telling you to be the best or dance the best or act the best or talk the best or just always be better than everyone. But instead, they should be saying, do your best, and not, you have to be the best. Because I'm a literary advocate who has an 88 in language arts, but I still strongly believe that literacy is important for Black girls, so it's...
That 88 is flash.
And actually, I'm gonna cut the second thing. So I have a poem that I'd like to share with you, and it is The Caged Bird by Maya Angelou, so I'm gonna try my best. Okay. A free bird leaps off the back of the wind and floats downstream till the current ends and dips his wing in the orange sun rays and dares to claim the sky. But a bird that stalks his narrow cage can barely see through his bars of rage. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown, but long for still,
and his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom. The free bird thinks of another breeze, and the trade soft winds through the sighing trees, and the fat worms waiting on the dawn bright lawn, and he names the sky his own. But that caged bird stands on the grave of dreams. His shadow shouts on a nightmare scream. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The caged bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still. And his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for bringing the spirit of our loving queen, Maya Angelou, to this space. Maya Asia.
I want everyone to leave here today and know that, like, I acknowledge every Black woman that's in this room. And like, I am here to share my story, and I'm here to also hear your story. I also want everyone to leave knowing that school push out and push out in general is real, that it could be affecting someone and they might not say nothing. So when you leave here, like, talk to your children, talk to your sisters, talk to your son, your daughter, your brother, because it is happening and no one's speaking up. I also want you guys to leave here with my GoFundMe. Help me get to South Africa. I need $5,000.
I think that's doable.
My GoFundMe is www.gofundme.com/mc2sa.
All right.
Olivia.
I really just want everyone here to leave with all the stuff you've been told today about how you are special and you do matter, with all the things that these 5 girls over here have told you, and what the workshops, what you've learned from those workshops and of the other panels. I just want you to take what you learned from those things that you've done in the past 3 days or one day, however long you've been here, and just take those and put them into action in your life, and to help you be noticed, because you are somebody and each and every one of you is special. So
thank you. And each and every one of you are special. So let's give it up one more time for this amazing panel. Yes. Olivia, Maya, Marley, Danielle, Asia, Ajara, thank you so much for sharing your brilliance with us. Thank you for relaying your stories to us. So many different calls to action and things that we need to pay attention to, that we need to allow space for Black girls to be, that Black girls are beautiful and we slay. That we need to do our work as a community that is looking at and lifting up Black girls to make sure that we are helping them before they are harmed. Thank you for that, Danielle. To do our best, we need to just think about being our best. And I think this talks to what Camille was telling us earlier today. If you were here dancing with Camille Brown earlier this morning, say, hey. So she woke us up with movement. And one of the things that she noted was that when she said that it was a competition, that's when we really turned up. And she asked us, why are we waiting until it's a competition before we do our best? All right, so thank you for reminding us of that as well, Marley, that we need to continue to share stories, that we need to be active in paying attention to school pushouts and the impact on our girls and our young people as a whole, that we're also trying to get you to South Africa, and Ajara might need some support to Cuba. So if you're trying to help these Black girls travel, make sure you come see them so they can experience Cuba and South Africa this summer. And last but not least, that we are all special, reminded of that by Olivia, and that we need to take action on all the amazing things that we've gathered from today and from these 3 days at the conference. So again, thank you for being panelists with us, being the final panelists of this conference, and thank you to all of you for giving them your attention and sharing with them your love. So one time for this amazing group of panelists. You know you want to stand up one more time for them. You know you want to stand up one more time for them. You really want to show them your love. You want to applaud. Yes. And you want to get them to Cuba and to South Africa too. I see you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let me use my. We have a really special guest who would just like to come to the stage and say thank you. Before I bring her up to the stage, I just want to read a quick quote from Martin Luther King. So when he was in jail in Birmingham for protesting segregation in Alabama, he wrote this famous letter to fellow clergy members. And here's just a quote from it. And he says, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. I would agree with St. Augustine that an unjust law is no law at all. So our fellow conference participant is an inspiration to girls across the country. Before Bree Newsom committed an act of civil disobedience to take down the flag in South Carolina, Nia Kenny used her phone to videotape her classmate who was being physically assaulted by a school safety officer in their high school in South Carolina. Both girls were subsequently arrested, and Nia, who was simply videotaping her friend being assaulted, was also arrested as well. And so she's here. It was really important for us to have Nia. She's an inspiration to so many of us for committing the act of Black Girl Magic, for committing the act of friendship and feminism, and committing the act of saving, or at least trying to preserve, the dignity of another Black girl. So I just want to bring her up to the stage. She's here with her mother, Doris, and Nia.
Yes, yes, all this love. How's everyone doing today? That's good, that's good. Well, I'm Nia Kenny, and I'm here from South Carolina. And you may know me because on October 26th, I stood up for my classmate, Shakara, as she was assaulted by an SRO at our high school. As a result, I was arrested and charged with disturbing schools, which is a prime example of school pushout, right? Right? I just wanted to take this moment and thank everybody, y'all, for all the love and support, cards, letters, and just everything. I want to thank Columbia University, GGE, and anyone else who made it possible for me to be here today. I'm gaining valuable information that I'm taking home and I'm going to share with young Black girls in Columbia. I've started a campaign called Every Black Girl.
Y'all see my shirt?
Y'all see my shirt? It's a national campaign focused on bringing awareness and solutions to issues impacting Black girls to create a safe environment where every Black girl can thrive.
Thank you. Let's another round of applause. So throughout today a young group of girls through the organization Girls for Gender Equity have been, Girls for Gender Equity, woo! Have been leading us in another form of protest and dignity-making art and transformative work. And they've been leading a charge called the Black Girls Declaration of Freedom and Humanity. And so I'm going to bring up three girls from GGE just to share the status of our collective Black Girls Declaration of Freedom and Humanity, which I do think is going to trump the Declaration of Independence in terms of its vision and boldness. So Shanice Patterson, Zainab Abdemullah, and Farah Farzana.
Hello, we are Sisters in Strength. My name is Shanice. First, I would like to thank everybody who contributed to the Black Girls Bill of Rights. We read over everything that you guys wrote, which was great, and we compiled them into a list, and here's what we came up with. So, it's called the Black Girls Bill of Rights, but we came up with another name, Black Girls Declaration of Freedom and Humanities. When you hear the word freedom and humanities, the first thing that comes to mind is like, why freedom, why humanities? Well, we chose freedom because for many years, Black girls, not just Black girls, but people of color have been put down and haven't been able to access their freedom and be able to be free to speak their mind and be open. And so we chose freedom because we want to take back our freedom. And we chose humanities because it's important for girls and young boys to learn about where they come from, where we come from, our background, our history, arts, philosophy, literature. We want to know, we want them to know that their background is important. It helps them become who they are. So it's important to learn about their history and their heritage. So that's why we chose freedom and humanities.
Hi everyone, my name is Fariha, and so we're just gonna get started with the Black Girl Declaration of Freedom and Humanity. So first, what we've got up are Black girls deserve the right to education and information about Black history and African history. So I felt that this was really important in that, you know, Black girls and young girls of color deserve a right to really experience where they've come from, what their history is, because most of the time, and I'm sure most of you can relate to this, most of the time what happens is we spent most of the school curriculum talking about the white man, talking about how Europeans colonized the Americas and how they colonized basically the rest of the world. But we spend very, very little time talking about African American history and the history of Black people. You know, like I can name so many European kings, I can name who they've colonized, what they've done, their accomplishments to American society. But we can't really like name a couple of Black people who have contributed to our society and who have helped shape America. So I just really felt that it was important for that to be up on the Bill of Rights.
Hi, my name is Zainab, and the next one is safety and the right to having our physical, emotional, and mental health protected and nurtured. And that's very important because home is where we learn to love and love ourselves. So if our physical, emotional, mental health is not okay, like how do we expect to love ourselves and other people? So we gotta make sure, and also we need to validate our mental health because I know when it comes to mental health in the Black community, it's very like, Yes, taboo. It's just like, I mean, I experienced it myself with experiencing it, mental health. I've been invalidated by my family, so I feel like it needs to be validated. So,
The next one is agency over our own bodies in every space. Well, we deserve to say what we should do with our own body. It's our body, so it's our choice. We should be able to do what we please because it's our body. We have control over what we do and what we say, and we shouldn't be dictated by anybody to say, oh, you should do this and you should be do that. Play and fun. Well, a little girl around 4 or 5 wrote this, and we thought it was like the most important one on the paper. So like when we think about this, when you think of fun and play, I can give like an experience. Like when me and my friends are on the train or like in a public setting, we are looked and we laugh and we're talking, we're looked at by other people like we're doing something wrong, like we're not allowed to speak, we're not allowed to like have fun. Like what's wrong with us laughing and smiling? Why is it so bad for us to be happy? So that's the reason why we chose fun and play, because we should be able to have fun and do what we please and be happy just to be us.
Express her blackness however she defines it without judgment. That basically means that no matter how, like, a lot of times we feel like, as black people ourselves, we feel like to judge other black people because of how much black they are. Like, if somebody's mixed, like, they're not black enough, or how that person is too black. So I feel like no matter what, if we identify as black, we should be able to define what we think is black to us and be free to, you know, express ourselves being black. So. Okay. The next one is to be free from stereotypes. So I'm assuming everybody knows what a stereotype is. So another one is to be free from our, well, that makes sense. Okay, being unique. So we should be able to be unique without being judged and free from insecurities. I feel like we should be confident and we shouldn't always feel like we need to compete for things that are unnecessary. Like competition is good, but when it's competition for things that will make us feel bad about ourselves, it's no good. So we should be able to love ourselves.
Sexual education and access to quality contraceptives and females' hygiene products. Okay, so in schools, like, we should be able to learn about, like, just our bodies, basically, how to, like, how to take care of ourselves and not to be afraid to, like, speak about things that are important, because it is important to learn about, like, sexual health. So it should be taught in every school because young people do deserve to learn about this. Also, access to contraceptive, like public, like schools should be able to talk to students about like how to use like stuff like that, and we should have access to it, like especially good, like quality. It should not be like poor stuff that would be easy to like rip or tear or stuff like that. We need it to be good quality because we deserve the best, because if we're trying to protect ourselves, then that we need to have like the best. Also, female hygiene products too. Well, as you guys know, female products are very expensive, and how is it fair when there's like thousands of females in the world? Like, we deserve to like have products that are not so expensive. Like, this is something that we need, and like we go into stores and they're very expensive, and they don't think about like our backgrounds, like how much, like if we're financially stable, we have to think about that, because that goes into like a lot of our lives, because that money is taking out like to pay for it, and they don't think about how other families' circumstances. So the prices for hygiene products should be lowered. Also, community and sisterhood to come together. When we think of like community and sisterhood, like we should uplift each other, not bring each other down. Like Zaina said, we shouldn't be in competition with each other. We should lift each other up and not put each other down. Also, we should not like look to other things like social media, like stuff like that, like put down females, because on like TV, like we're seeing like females as sex symbols. Like we see them like in competition with each other, like shows like Bad Girls Club that paints black people in like a really bad image, not just black people, but people of color in a bad way. And that's unfair because that's only one side to the story. So we should be put ourselves in a better light and uplift each other.
And so one of the last bullet points we have is justice no matter what it looks like. So justice for young girls no matter what it looks like. So one of the things that we all like came up with, a lot of people came up with, was sexual assault. Justice for sexual assault victims, for rape victims. No statute of limitations for rape and sexual assault victims. Because what does that really say? That says that there's a limit to there's a limit to our voices. It's limiting our voices to say, if somebody was sexually assaulted or raped, they only have 10 years to speak out about it. And if their 10 years are up, they can't say anything anymore. So what does that tell young girls? That tells young girls, especially young girls of color, that their voices are limited, that their voices are powerless after a certain amount of time. So, you know, we should have access, we should have the right to speak out about injustices and speak out about our experiences and what has happened to us. And also we have reparations and indictment of police officers who murder people of color or even assault people of color, because look at everything that's happening right now, especially with the Black Lives Matter movement, all of these police officers who have been, you know, it's clear that they are guilty and it's clear that they've killed young men and young women of color, but they're not being indicted, nothing's being done. So where's the justice in that for us? You know, how are we being justified in that? So we just thought it was really important to encompass all of these things in a Bill of Rights. Yeah, and also, we just want to thank everybody who contributed to this, because it was really a collective effort. We couldn't have done this on our own. So just thank you, and it really is a collective effort. And we just also want to say that this isn't where it stops. This is an ongoing movement. We're going to keep doing this, and we're going to keep pushing for these rights. And I urge all of you to do the same thing. You know, this is just the beginning. So, yeah.